So joining us this morning is Sonny Africa of IBON Foundation for a chat, for a preview, a GDP preview chat. Hi, Sonny. Good morning.
Hi, morning, Mimi. How are you doing?
Okay. So Sonny, first of all, what's your number for first and second quarter GDP? And could you very briefly tell us the assumptions behind those estimates?
Well, unfortunately, we expect the first quarter GDP to still be negative. We'll probably only start seeing positive growth in the low single digit, of course, by the second quarter. For the first quarter, we're hoping we're at least going to hit -5% contraction. I think that's important because we won't get a fighting chance at even just 4 to 5% GDP growth for the whole year if we do worse than -5% contraction for the first quarter. So we're hoping for that, but again, you know, it ain't over until the fat lady sings. So we'll see how that turns out tomorrow morning.
So what kind of music are you expecting the fat lady to sing, Sonny? I mean, what are you banking on? This hope. Where is this hope coming from?
It's actually not hopeful. We're expecting the first quarter GDP figures actually to be at least -5% contraction and hopefully not worse, but possibly worse. Our main assumption there is that we're not seeing an improving jobs market. Domestic demand is still very repressed. Interest rates are at a record low, but no one's really borrowing or investing. Despite the seemingly good jobs figures in March, actually about almost 3 million of those were in informal work with low earnings, irregular quality of work. So we're not actually seeing any boost in aggregate demand from the jobs market. Construction is still quite tepid. The infrastructure program, a lot of it's actually also import intensive. There's a lot of drain in infrastructure spending going abroad. So we're not seeing the domestic aggregate demand boost we should be seeing to see better GDP figures, not just for the first quarter, but for the remainder of the year.
Sonny, for those who are going to be monitoring the announcement tomorrow morning, what number, beyond the headline number, should we be paying close attention to?
I think it'd be very important to look at the trade, agriculture, and construction figures. If the output contraction there is still quite large, that's going to be a sign of more problems down the road, mainly because the first few months of the year have seen employment increasing in these three sectors. They've been crowding into these sectors. But again, if the output growth or the contraction improvement is not commensurate to the jobs increase, that implies very low incomes. And very low incomes means, unfortunately, depressed consumption and depressed demand. So I think that's one key indicator to look at there. Also, I think the household consumption expenditure is quite important. We've seen four quarters of contraction so far. If it's still negative, that indicates really bad household welfare for millions of Filipinos.
Sonny, going back to the jobs, we actually got improving jobs numbers from last week. Unemployment rate was down compared to the previous month, but do they tell us anything beyond this one data point?
Actually, that's a bit of a problem there because the improving unemployment rate to about, I think, 45.3 million and the lowering unemployment rate to 7.7, it masks some really poor quality work. If you look at compared to last year, maybe January 2020, before the pandemic, we only created less than 350,000 wage and salary workers. The biggest increase in employment have been in self-employed workers without any employees. It's like, you know, people selling stuff online maybe or on the street. And then a huge 1 million increase in unpaid family workers. There are almost 4 million unpaid family workers right now on top of the almost 13 million self-employed. And I think that's a very bad sign because that does show that the jobs being created are actually poor quality jobs. Also want to highlight, I think it's quite critical. There's much more part-time work now than full-time work. I think, you know, that's a good indication that despite the seemingly improved unemployment figures and employment figures, if the quality of work is low, that still means low incomes, that still means low household welfare, it still means actually depressed aggregate demand in the coming period and, you know, not so good GDP figures.
Yeah. Okay. Sonny, we're down to the last 12 months of President Duterte's term. What should be, you think, the priority of his economic managers on top of their agenda as they try to build Mr. Duterte's economic legacy?
You know, the best thing about President Duterte's take off the start of his administration was to shake things up. I think to correct poverty, to correct inequality, that would have been amazing. He hasn't been doing that the last four and a half years. But if we get some surprise in his finishing stretch, we see major reforms in wealth and income redistribution to increase domestic demand also at the lower income levels. If you see a much stronger push to strengthen Philippine agriculture and Philippine industry, I think that's a starting point of a good legacy. If not, if we see the same thing, he's going to end up being among the worst performing administrations even before the pandemic. And I think that's quite sad.
Okay, you mentioned reforms, last minute reforms. I know that your group has been pushing for a tax on the super rich. Could you care to explain why you think that should be the case? I mean, tax reform was supposed is actually one of the legacies of the Duterte administration, with a train law, with a create law, and now you want the super rich taxed. Don't you think that's bad timing? And frankly, quite unfair, considering that a lot of these tycoons, the private sector in general, their big businesses, are already holding up half the sky, so to speak, when it comes to supporting their employees, even through vaccination.
First, to be clear, the biggest corporations don't actually account for the majority of work in the Philippines. The majority of work in the Philippines is still in the informal sector. More than half of the economy is informal. I think very easily two-thirds of the economy is in the unregistered informal sector, including micro, small, and medium enterprises. So I think that impression that the tycoons hold up the economy, that's actually not true.
But Sonny, very quickly, before I get to your next point, don't you think that these MSMEs survive because they're part of the supply chain of the big players?
I think that that's an empirical question. We don't have enough data for that. But a big part of it is actually in the informal agricultural sector. It's like, you know, bordering on the subsistence level. So we do have some portion of agriculture hooked up into the agribusiness chains of these big corporations. But I think it does remain the case, the overwhelming majority of the economy is not actually tied whether into the inputs or the output chains of these big firms.
And sorry, the proposal, Sonny, is to tax those with 1 billion pesos, 1% of this additional tax, 2 billion pesos, 2%, 3 billion, 3 pesos, 3%.
The basic idea is it's basically idle wealth right now. I mean, of course, a portion of it is being invested, but to the extent that we're talking about, you know, maybe 4.1 trillion in wealth for the 50 richest Filipinos, we think a net, basically almost a 6% tax on their wealth, one, won't affect their welfare, won't affect their investment decisions, but it frees up financing for the government to spend on things like healthcare, education, social protection. I think that's a very strong income and wealth redistribution measure that could be considered. It boosts aggregate demand at really no welfare cost to the very rich. And I think if a country like the United States, one of the most advanced capitalist countries in the world, can consider that, I think the Philippines should be about time for the Philippines to start considering that same kind of pseudo-socialist measure as well.
Okay, interesting thoughts there. Sonny, thank you so much for joining us and for your insights. Always a pleasure to speak with you. We're going to have to see whether the number comes out at least 5% contraction or hopefully better.
Hope for the best. Expect the worst.
Okay. Thank you, Sonny. Have a good day.
Bye-bye.